Growing up in Michigan, it's cold. No, really, it's frickin' cold. As a kid, my mom was always worried about frostbite. But what is it, and why is Jack Frost so nibbly? Hello, my frosty friends. Trace here for DNews. Frostbite is a medical condition where your skin and underlying tissue can literally start to freeze, a bit like a human popsicle. Being exposed to extremely cold temperatures combined with fast winds, like those on Mount Everest, can see frostbite set in within just 5 minutes. So what is frostbite really like? Well, we were fortunate enough to talk to a former Everest expedition leader, Bob Hoffman, about his experience with frostbite.
I had a couple of close calls on Everest. It's one of those mountains, no matter how experienced you are, something can always go wrong.
Everest's summit is located at an elevation of almost 29,000 feet. Now, at that altitude, a climber's body has a lot to contend with, which may be why it's often referred to as the death zone. Average temperatures here fluctuate between negative 31 Fahrenheit in winter to a pleasant negative 4 in summer, and wind speeds during the May climbing season are usually over 100 miles an hour. In fact, the highest wind speed on Everest was 175 miles an hour, recorded in February 2004.
On my last climb in 2003, I was on the summit and we had some lousy weather. It was extremely windy and very cold. The ice was just blowing off and you felt you were being sandblasted.
Normally, our core temperature is a cozy 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit. This temperature is actually crucial for maintaining the critical body functions that keep us alive. But strong winds and frigid temperatures can make staying warm a constant challenge, which is why if our core temperature starts to dip for any reason, the hypothalamus, that's the thermoregulatory center of our brain, springs into survival mode in order to protect our vital organs and maintain that core temperature. See, our blood carries oxygen molecules for energy, but also distributes warmth to every part of our body. If your core temperature is compromised, your blood vessels will constrict and divert that warmth away from the extremities and toward the vital organs. Basically, you can live without an arm, but not without lungs or your intestines, and your body knows it. Once the hypothalamus diverts the warmth to protect your inner organs, your extremities are then vulnerable to frostbite. Frostbite progresses in three stages. The first stage, called frostnip, is where the surface of the skin freezes. During the second stage, called superficial frostbite, the tissue beneath the skin starts to freeze. And by the third stage, known as deep frostbite, your muscles, tendons, nerves, and blood vessels start to freeze. It's at this point that your skin may start to turn dark blue or black, indicating that the tissue is dead, and you're probably going to lose some fingers and toes. This is all pretty scary stuff. With the right gear, you can endure cold weather for a time without suffering from frostbite or hypothermia. However, as Bob found out, you can't always rely on it.
The Sherpa that I was climbing with, Pimba, motioned to me that my oxygen mask was icing up where you exhale. And as I tried to clear it, I broke the oxygen tube going into the mask.
Climbers also have to cope with limited oxygen in the air, which is why they always carry their own oxygen supply. When the body is starved of oxygen, that's called hypoxia. Hypoxia triggers altitude sickness, leaving climbers with a shortness of breath, elevated heart rates, and feelings of confusion. And for some reason, if a climber does find themselves without oxygen, the severity of frostbite can dramatically increase.
When I stood up to start going down, my legs just collapsed out from underneath me. I didn't have the strength to stand up.
Altogether, it's a perfect storm of awful. Bob was experiencing something called high-altitude frostbite, a deadly combination of frostbite, dehydration, and hypoxia. Aware of these compounding dangers, Bob knew he had to reach base camp and find medical help as soon as possible.
For the next 12 hours, I crawled, slid, and fell down the mountain. And I knew that if I stopped, I'd die where I stopped, but managed to get down to a high camp. I paid the price with some pretty severe frostbite on my feet.
Luckily, he lived to tell the tale, and although you may not find yourself in the same position as Bob anytime soon, it's worth remembering that you don't have to climb Everest to experience frostnip, frostbite, or hypothermia. So, if you're planning a cold climate adventure, make sure you wrap up to keep warm. Climbing Mount Everest is not for the faint of heart, and seldom few have managed it without the help of a knowledgeable Sherpa guide on Everest. Don't forget to tune in to the premiere of Sherpa, airing Saturday, April 23rd at 9, 8 Central, as part of the Elevation Weekend on Discovery. And as always, thanks for watching DNews. Don't forget to subscribe.